But in order to stick to our programme, I'm going to introduce our first speaker of this session, Nicole Gelinas. She's the Searle Freedom Trust Fellow at the Manhattan Institute and contributing editor of City Journal. Gelinas writes on urban economics and finance, on municipal and corporate finance, and on business issues. Her most recent book is called After the Fall, Saving Capitalism from Wall Street and Washington, published in 2009. She's written on a wide variety of subjects, and in particular about issues like city infrastructure. So this last session, transport in the new metro is a vital piece of infrastructure. Over to you, Nicole.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Morris. Thank you all for staying. It's kind of like the kids who show up the day after the prom. They're the ones who get the lecture on all the people who didn't show up the day after the prom, so thank you. So how did I get here? This is not an existential question. I took the E train, and starting my trip to London on Saturday morning, went outside of my house in Midtown Manhattan at 5:45 a.m. and took 30 steps, walked underground to get on the subway line. Now, 5:45 on a Saturday is early. There was a rat at one end of the platform, a very large rat walking around, and there were two homeless people sleeping on the steps of the subway. Post-Bloomberg New York is not a perfect place, but there were other people taking the train at 5:45 in the morning. There were not a lot of people, but there were people on the platform with me, enough to feel safe. And once I got on the train, another two and three stops as we left Manhattan, got into Queens on our way out to the airport, the train was filled. There were no seats on the train. 20 years ago, this would have been a rush hour capacity train. If you had brought someone onto this train in the 1980s, they would have said, this is a busy Friday afternoon rush hour train, not a dawn train going up to Queens. And this is really a miracle that this could happen. A person going back to even further, to the late 1970s, to the early 80s, you would have to be insane to think that you were going to get on a subway train in the pre-dawn hours and take it an hour all the way out to Queens. The New Yorker's creed was safety in numbers. You take the subway at rush hours, you don't take the trains after dark, and if you're very, very brave, the rule is you don't take the trains after 10 p.m. My husband, who's a little bit older than me, his creed well up until the past 10 years was never, ever, ever take the subway after 10 p.m. But you get on the Barclays Center in Brooklyn, go back to Manhattan after an event at the Barclays Center or at the Brooklyn Academy of Music, you will not find a seat on these subway trains. And this is really what got New York's regeneration going. Again, go back to the early 1980s, the transit system had hit bottom. It had suffered decades of neglect, not underinvestment, but really no investment. Since the 1960s, when the city had started to spend more and more money on social programs rather than large-scale infrastructure, no one had put capital investment money into the transit system. This is not a lack of building new transit. This was a lack of keeping up the old system. It's 100 years old. It was old in the 1960s. It needs billions of dollars worth of investment in today's dollars just to keep in working order. So 30 years of neglect, trains were abandoned en route every single day. People could not get reliably to work. They would have to get notes from the transit authority to say why they were late. And people were leaving the city. The decline of mass transit was a symbol of the decline of the city. People no longer wanted to sit on a crowded subway train. They wanted to sit in their nice car and drive to their nice job and live in a suburb and work in a suburb. Now, what turned that around? It was a concerted decision in the early 80s on behalf of the city's business leaders, the city's elected political leaders, and the states, Albany, New York State political capital. All of these elected officials said, we are going to bet that New York City can and will come back. And this was not a cheap bet. It was billions of dollars, even in the currency back then, to get transit back to a state of good repair, it took $10 billion over the first 10 years of this program, starting in the early 80s, going into the early 1990s. How did the city get that money? Business leaders went to Albany and said, we will support a new tax to subsidize transit, new taxes on the downstate New York region, everything from mortgage transfers to sales tax to petroleum tax, a big new package of taxes that they hoped were small enough that no one would notice, but big enough when you put them all together to add up to a lot of money against which the city's transit authority could borrow and make these massive investments. Now, over the past 20 years, transit ridership is up 58%. And if you think about New York's economic success stories, the downtown Brooklyn Triangle, a place where tech entrepreneurs, other small-scale manufacturing entrepreneurs have located business over the past decade. Why did they go to the downtown Brooklyn Tech Triangle? Because there were many, many subway lines that all converged here. Up until New York started to come back, regain population, these subway lines were underused. Today, they're over capacity, or quite close to being over capacity. Same thing with the L train that goes out to Williamsburg, Brooklyn. 25 years ago, as the former head of our transit agency likes to remind us, the city was thinking about shutting down the L train. There was nobody riding the train. Bloomberg rezoned the Williamsburg-Brooklyn waterfronts, encouraged building of apartments, residential homes. Once he did that, starting almost a decade ago now, the L train platforms were so crowded, the people who went and lived and worked there had to wait for three or four trains to go by before Transit Authority finally was able to make more technological investments, so it had the signaling to add new capacity. And even today, these trains are more crowded than our most crowded trains were 2 and 3 decades ago. We've seen the same thing happen in London. Underground ridership is up 40% over the past 15 years. London is adding hours to the tube system, realizing that it has to have the tube that doesn't close down, at least on high volume weekends, if it's going to support its nightlife, support restaurants, industry, and so forth. So this is part of the revitalization of cities. It came in New York, indeed, before New York started to get crime under control. Murder rate kept going up until the early 1990s, but we had made this institutional decision to invest in transit well before that. If we hadn't done that, we would not have the New York that we have today. And the same is true for London, making these massive investments currently in Crossrail and other projects. Now, this is also part of a trend, and it's hard to say what's cause, what's effect, but the millennial generation, not everybody, but enough of them to matter, they don't want the kind of 20th century suburban car-oriented lifestyle. Our Transit Authority commissioned a study of the millennials and found what we kind of already know. Car use peaked. It's not recession-based. Auto use peaked in New York in 2005. People are not driving their cars into the city in as great as volumes as they were a decade ago. Younger people, as the National Association of Realtors said for this study, they want to walk, bike, car share, and use public transportation, and they want to live where that's all easy to do. And that is very true if you see the young population moving to cities like New York, moving to cities like London. People a little bit younger than me and of my generation, we grew up in a stultified suburban environments. We spent our childhoods in the back of our parents' cars, and we said, this is not the life we want to live. We want to be able to get from New York to London, New York to other global cities, without having to set foot in an automobile, and indeed we can do that now. Now, this is where, and by the way, it's not just young people, it's seniors as well. I was here about a month ago, read a story in one of the papers that James would say is not a quality paper about how seniors don't like British downtowns outside of London. They feel like they can't walk around them and so forth. Senior citizens have difficulty driving after a certain age can maintain their independence in cities with subway and bus systems. And if you look at New York in the past decade, senior rides on buses and subways have gone up by 30%. So good for old people, good for young people, and hopefully good for people in the middle as well. Now, what does this mean for the cities, both in America and in Britain, that have really struggled to maintain population? You know, young people want to live in cities, but they want to live in certain cities. And you look at the population trend of cities outside of London since the post-war era, in some cases going back to the Depression. Liverpool obviously lost massive, massive population. Population peaked in the 1930s. Manchester lost population. Sheffield, Bristol, and Leeds to a lesser extent. And Birmingham kind of holding its own at a million. But the problem with cities that have a university base is that they can attract people, attract young people, but they can't get them to stay. We have a similar problem in a city called Rochester in upstate New York. It had 332,000 people half a century ago, now down to about 210,000. They get young people and smart young people to go to the university, but then when they're done, they want to go to a city where you've got public transit, because the density that they desire above ground is dependent on the heavy scale transit underground. So the kind of good news is that these cities can attract people from around the world. The bad news is that, the more challenging news, is that it's going to take massive capital investments. And this is not, you know, a lot of times cities think, in their right to do these things, Liverpool, for example, wants to turn a roadway into a high-line park like New York did. Cities are doing trams, light rails, and so forth, making bicycle lanes on streets, having more the kind of pocket parks, trying to make the streets denser and more livable. And that's all good, but there's a physics issue here. You cannot achieve the density that people want and need in their global cities unless you've got a capital-intensive, heavy rail system, not a commuter rail system, but really a tube-style, subway-style, underground rail system within the city. That's the only way you can move people around the city, inside the city, without having to be dependent on the automobile. And as soon as you're stuck being dependent on the automobile, you turn away these people that you want to attract, not only because of the subway system itself, but because too much dependence on the automobile means you can't make enough safe space for bicyclists, for walkers. You can't have a walkable city and a city that is friendly to automobiles at the same time. I think that high-speed rail, HS2, to connect all of these southern cities together and connect them closer to London, this is a good idea. It's, you know, people say that it's expensive, but we have to put it in context. You're looking at £42.6 billion for both phases of this program, including a big contingency. It sounds like a lot, but the Britain will spend $110 billion on national healthcare this year. That's fine. Both of these things are valid expenditures, but it's important to say this is a capital investment over many, many years that eventually will pay off. Another way of looking at it as competing with other needs for finite resources, again, £42.6 billion sounds like a lot of money, but a program like Help to Buy to subsidize the financial industries lending too much money to young people who are paying too much money for houses, this is another call on the government's balance sheet. When you are spending too much money on, or any money, on subsidizing home purchases, you're not spending that money or that portion of the balance sheet on the transit that helps you get to those homes, whether they're in London or elsewhere in the country. And we obviously have these same problems of what is infrastructure and how do you allocate your infrastructure money at home, both in New York and the rest of the country. And so HST was good, but it's really not enough. It should really be coupled with massive investments in large-scale underground subway system transit infrastructure in these other cities. And that's a big risk. It is a multi-decade risk that these cities can and will succeed, that they just need this size and scale of government planning and investment to do it. But again, you know, just to conclude, transit is not transit. Transit is an anti-poverty program. Taking the E-train from Manhattan to Queens on a weekend day, the income disparities in these train cars, you've got people making minimum wage jobs, taking this train to the airport, to work at the airport. They could not do this if they had to pay for a car. Having a government-run and subsidized transit system allows them to avoid $300 to $800 in monthly spending to buy and maintain a car. This is a public health program. Having a dense transit system supporting a dense city means fewer people dying in car crashes, fewer pedestrians dying, fewer bicyclists dying as well. Cities have the best auto rate deaths and pedestrian and bicyclist deaths per capita, and the denser cities have the best rates. You are more likely to stay alive walking in London than you are walking in Houston, Atlanta, much less dense cities. And it's also a mobility program. In New York City, we have specialized exam high schools. There's only three of them, three of the legacy ones. If you are a middle schooler, your family is poor or middle class, can't go to private school, you can take the test, pass the test, and go to these exam schools. I talked to a young man who just graduated, a Chinese American, moved to New York when he was 5, commuted every day on the subway from Queens to Lower Manhattan, couldn't do that without this very dense subway system. And by doing that, he went to the exam school, said he learned more there than he has been at Harvard. So, and it's also a housing program. When people talk about the need for housing, whether it's in London or suburban areas or other cities, anytime someone says we need to build housing, the first question should be, how are you going to get people from the housing to work and to other things they want to do? You cannot build housing in New York, London, or elsewhere unless you've got the transit capacity to support it. And I guess that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole. That's excellent. Our next speaker is Tony Travers. Tony needs absolutely no introduction to the London cohort of our audience, but for sake of anybody visiting from another planet who doesn't know him, Tony Travers is Director of Visiting Professor of LSE London, which is a research centre at the London School of Economics. He's also a visiting professor in the LSE's government department. His key research interests include local and regional government and public service reform, exactly the issues that we've been talking about today. He's currently an advisor to the House of Commons Children's Schools and Families Select Committee and to the Communities and Local Government Select Committee. He has published endless books, all of which are incredibly readable. They include Failure in British Government, The Politics of Poll Tax, we won't go there, Paying for Health, Education and Housing, How Does the Centre Pull the Purse Strings, marvellous stuff, I promise you, and The Politics of London, Governing the Ungovernable City, on which note, Tony Travers.
Thank you, Steve, I think, good afternoon all. How many minutes do you want to speak for?
15,
okay. Well, first I want to talk a little bit about London, but I also want to broaden this out to look at cities around the rest of the UK. We've heard a bit about New York, I'll glancing also to New York as well, I know that's a theme today. And then particularly end up by looking at the challenge for all cities of making investments in their transport. So the issue that we just heard flagged up, which I think is absolutely essential to these cities, that is, how can they capture the value of the economic product within them in a way that directs resources at their investment needs, particularly for transport. Now, everybody who lives in a city understands that those cities, metropolitan areas more generally, are dependent on infrastructure. One of the things you learn if you live in a city is that you rely on infrastructure more than if you live in the countryside. Indeed, the more rural the area you live in, the more you can get by without electricity, sewage, any of these things, because there it all is, you can just sort of survive. Never been very rural kind of person myself, but that's what I'm told it's like. In cities, on the other hand, and certainly the more densely populated your city, and the bigger and more densely populated the city is, the more you just know, you depend on the lights being switched on the metro working that morning, on all aspects of the physical infrastructure functioning, because if it doesn't, disaster will soon follow. Of course, there's a lot of work being done on agglomerations and clustering, experts here gathered, and that, of course, reinforces the idea that agglomerations, clustering in large urban areas themselves depend on the capacity for large numbers of people to travel in and out and or around these cities. And you can't do that just by car. You end up doing that, and we just heard, by various forms of mass transit, or on foot, or on bicycle, or other forms of flexible transport within the city centre, some of it public, much of it public, but not all of it, some of it different forms of private. We mustn't, however, forget that the outer area of cities, even great public transport cities, also rely on cars and roads. Even in a city like London, which is an absolutely in the middle of a spider's web of transport, if you live beyond the inner boroughs, you will rely extensively on cars. That's not to say can't be encouraged to use your car slightly less. You can have borough-based strategies for dealing with that. But in the end, cars do matter, sorry, roads and cars do matter as well. And we mustn't, as it were, think about accidentally persecuting those that rely on getting around in other means. Now, there is also, of course, from cities' point of view, and I've always been interested by the aesthetics of this, the importance of transport system as image. Most obviously understood in this city by the most famous of all its icons, probably, and certainly up there with police officer uniforms, black taxis and red buses, that is the underground map. The underground map, designed by Harry Beck, an electrical engineer, much copied around the world in towns and cities that want to use aesthetics, use a diagram to suggest that the city is something that can be understood and which actually is in itself urban in its functioning. That idea suggests to me anyway that transport doesn't only fulfill a function as a way of getting about, as we all understand, and reminding people about their need for infrastructure, but that in addition, it's part of the signalling and the iconography of cities, something that tells us that this is a big, important city with a very important metro system. And a metro system is almost the pre-existing condition for being a big, successful city these days. Now, London, as we know, has a massive, extensive system of public transport. Actually, the underground that I've just mentioned is only a small part of it. The commuter railway, run by a mixture of public authorities and private companies, is actually geographically rather bigger. So the underground and the national railway system added together are, I think, the largest urban rail network in the world. Now, elsewhere in Britain, things are different. Newcastle has a small metro, small, perfectly formed metro. Glasgow has something called Clockwork Orange, and you've been on that. Liverpool has a railway that functions as a sort of underground in the middle of the city, but these are very small by the standards of both their analogous cities overseas and indeed London. There are new tram systems in other cities in Britain, most notably recently in Edinburgh, finally opened after a number of years and much effort. Now, the reason I look at those cities as well within the UK is that I think it is clear to those cities, and I strongly support them in their objective, that they, like London, New York and Paris and other cities that are growing rapidly in the developing world, need transport infrastructure to make them function as effective economic centres. Outside London, metropolitan counties, as they used to be, transport authorities in their new form, do have the opportunity to get the advantage that Transport for London has. Now, Transport for London is the city transit authority in London. I think it's a very interesting example of a city-based transport authority. Steve here is on the board. I mean, we've certainly been on the board and still are on the board, just checking as I say it in case anything's happened, on the board. Transport for London, very interesting transit authority, because it brings together buses, underground, parts of the commuter rail system, many of the major roads, licensing of taxi cabs, licensing of mini cabs, river services. It even now owns a cable car. What more do you want? And it is indeed a developer of buses. It now develops buses in Northern Ireland as a rare example of British industrial policy. Now, the reason I stress this, it's a city-based transit authority, very different to the New York arrangement with all the stresses and strains that there are with a state agency trying to run or running a city-based service. And I think that Transport for London is, in many ways, one of London's great successes. It does show how a city-focused transport authority with influence and control over almost all aspects of the city's transport, and crucially, its ticketing. Rarely do governments do things that are universally popular, but the ticketing system, the Oyster card, now of course available in similar forms in many other cities and indeed evolving itself now into a contactless version of a travelling payment system, has undoubtedly been popular. As I say, there aren't many things governments do that are popular, but this undoubtedly is. The more remarkable in that, for economists among you, will know that it's actually quite an effective way of getting people to pay marginally for the journeys they make, which economists are very fond of. So it's something that everybody has won from. Now, I want to pick up the theme of the previous speaker just briefly before I finish. So having made the case for transport as an enabler of urban agglomeration, making the case for transport as the part of the iconography of cities, I want to talk rather more pragmatically about the question of how we pay for expanding transport systems in cities. This, it seems to me, is an absolutely key element, particularly because London, like New York, like London, and many other successful cities, is expanding. London's an old city, which is expanding very fast. And I've heard Steve make this point before. London's probably growing faster today in absolute terms than at any time in history. Not relatively, but absolutely. So by 100,000 to 125,000 a year. An extraordinary rate, and if anything, speeding up somewhat. Now, in that kind of city, the question is, how do we continue the progress that's been made in London in recent years? Actually, London has managed to develop a fair amount of infrastructure in recent years. The Docklands Light Railway, an extension to the Jubilee Line, various extensions to Heathrow Airport, the overground system, remarkable achievement almost by accident, the night bus system, which I would hazard to argue the New Yorkers in the audience, actually provides a rather more frequent service than any New York subway services at night, but just that's a bit of intercity competition. And many other things besides. Transport in London has improved in recent years. Now, we've heard absolutely accurately about the all-time record use of the tube, like the New York subway, and indeed there are now plans ahead, not only of building a crossrail across central London, not far from here, but even plans to build a second crossrail line north-south, and there's in fact another north-south line, Thames Link, about to open, reopen soon. Now, this brings me to the challenge, not unique to London, not unique to New York, and I know that this exact same issue has been having to be considered in New York as well, which is how to expand transport, not exactly in line with this population but increase, but at least not to lag too badly. Population of London, 8.5 million today, will rise to 10 million by 2030, and 10.5 or 11 million after that. There are all sorts of reasons for this, to do with natural increase in the city, immigration, and other aspects besides. So these figures are official and likely to occur. Even if they only half occurred, it's quite a challenge. And the difficulty that old cities face is how to make investments which, if they're not to be funded by upper levels of government, can't be entirely funded from the fare box. How can they be funded by other means? Usually by land capture or new taxes. New taxes, not very popular in Britain. And so you see both in New York and in London at the moment, examples of small extensions to undergrounds and subways, which are effectively using land capital, increase in land values, to fund part, at least, of new developments. This is Line 7 extension down the west side of Manhattan, and, of course, the Northern Line extension to Battersea, a two-line spur off the Northern Line, which will finally, one hopes, allow the Battersea Power Station area to develop. In fact, it is developing, so it's going to work. Now, both of these are in a slightly cumbersome method of trying to capture land value, successful, wise thing to try to do, in order to pay for the infrastructure that allows the development to occur in the first place, tax increment finance. In a lot of struggle and debate about this in Britain, this is a very good example of an idea that has been prevalent in the United States for years, which has taken the dear British rather a long time to adopt. But it does, I think, offer a model, a prototype, for how cities, particularly in the southern part of Britain, but any successful city in Britain, can take this further. And the question is, how do we link development to transport? Sort of, it's new in London. Lord Ashfield, the great sort of robber baron, head of London Transport, of London Passenger Transport Board, as it was called in those days, developed the Piccadilly Line, the Northern Line, and indeed the Metropolitan Line, but no, it wasn't the Metropolitan, Piccadilly Northern Line, and part of the Central Line, out to the north and the east, by simply buying up the land by compulsory purchase, putting down the tube, and then selling the land on either side. Rather aggressive version of it, rather hard to do that these days in a built-up city, but he understood, indeed it was he too, by the way, who understood the enormous merit of the earlier mentioned Beck Underground Line, which allowed him to give the impression in marketing these new services that the distance from the end of the Piccadilly Line to King's Cross was the same as the distance from King's Cross to Hyde Park Corner, which it most definitely is not. But using these maps, you can produce all sorts of fascinating visual illusions. So looking ahead, I think the big challenge for cities, particularly developed and successful cities, is to evolve mechanisms that allow them to capture the uplift in fares, land values, and otherwise from transport developments, which will in turn allow those developments to go ahead in the first place. Seems to be a big, big challenge. Upper levels of government, be they the state government in New York or central government in this country, will come under and do come under massive pressure not simply to spend more and more and more money in the big city. There's been a report this very day from the Transport Select Committee of the House of Commons arguing that, in effect, they don't quite put it like this, that investment in transport in London is so much higher than the rest of the country, something needs to be done. This is not unique to London. So I'll just leave you with this thought, that I do think the big challenge for cities is how to come up with arrangements that will allow these older metros in older cities which are expanding, older transport systems indeed in cities that are expanding, to capture, as I say, land value increases, possible tax increases, but perhaps even more than that, find a way for the city to make it possible for international investors, often all who want to invest in cities, so these kind of cities, to use their money not only to invest in housing, but also to invest in this kind of infrastructure. We in Britain have not managed to do that really so far. There are lots of people who want to invest in London, they can buy housing, but they cannot invest in big infrastructure projects. And if there was one thing that I would simply like to leave hanging in the air today, it is that these larger cities and their governments and their transport systems need to work harder and harder if they are to be able to cope with the population growth that lies ahead, in capturing the value of those developments in order to invest more in them. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed for that. Tony, our last speaker is Kevin Craven. Kevin is CEO of Balfour Beatty Services division. He's responsible in the company for finding smarter and more efficient and collaborative means of delivering innovative solutions across all of Balfour Beatty's very substantial businesses and, of course, for its clients. He also sits on the Confederation of British Industries Public Service Strategy Board. For our visitors, the Confederation of British Industry is a very substantial and respected industry body, so what it says carries a considerable amount of weight. Kevin.
Thank you, Steve. I'm afraid that I don't have the qualifications and intellectual capacity of some of my fellow panel members. But what I do is dig up some of our roads to the tune of some 6,000 holes every week. And if your train is late on a Monday morning, that's quite possibly some of my work's overrunning, I'm afraid. So on infrastructure, we tend to fix a lot of it and build a lot of it. And I'll give you a couple of perspectives around what we think should happen. So facts and figures first, and the implications for our transport systems. So our population in the UK will grow to over 73 million people by 2030. But included in that is the number of people over 85 will have doubled. 48% of men, 43% of women in the UK could be obese. Over 300,000 homes will be needed every single year. The way we live and work in these towns and cities is going to change. The obvious ones are things like more cycle lanes. But one of the less obvious ones is that the travel to work distances have stretched even further. It is now very common that people travel over 1 hour to get to work every day. I myself travel closer to 2 hours, even when things are working, which they quite often don't. And so the inevitable conclusion is our towns and cities will need to accommodate more people much more flexibly than they currently do. So what are the other trends that might impact on our infrastructure? So air travel will probably double by 2030. Air freight will probably triple. Container traffic through our ports and on our railways will probably quadruple. Even coming a little bit closer in time, we know that rail journeys will increase by 14% in the next 5 years alone. And the costs of all of this, the costs of congestions in the UK, will rise to £36 billion per annum by 2025. That's the same as the current budget for the MOD, by the way. So again, it seems inevitable that we will be spending more on our infrastructure. A recent study by McKinsey suggested that if we look backwards in the last 16 years, we will need to spend 60% more on infrastructure globally in the next 16 years just to keep pace with the anticipated growth. Is that really affordable for us in the UK? I mean, the global number is something phenomenal, like $57 trillion, which is an absolutely huge sum of money. So we need to change. And what are the things that we need to do differently? I mean, I think there are some structural barriers to change. Certainly in our local authorities and town halls, there is a duty only to maintain the statutory services, certainly no obligation to improve them. And if I take a very simple example, given the current level of funding, the condition of our local authority roads is deteriorating by about 2% every single year. That doesn't sound like very much, but it accelerates very rapidly if you add in the increased demand and the unusual weather conditions. In less than 10 years, our roads, your roads, will be 25% worse than they are now if we don't increase that level of funding. Again, against this background of reduced budgets and austerity, it seems to make sense to use what we have more effectively. Unfortunately, most budgets are ring-fenced and siloed. It's very difficult to get creative use of those budgets. So for example, the idea that you might use a transport budget or a health budget to create better conditions for public health seems a little bit too far at the moment. One of the big challenges we have in the UK is our legacy infrastructure. Here in the UK, many of our streets are designed for horses and carts, not necessarily the size and power of the vehicles we have today. Our utilities are also under stress, so we need more capacity in water, energy, broadband. But under the roads that we drive on, all of these services are a little bit like spaghetti, frankly. And they've evolved rather than being designed. So very often the delays that you experience are because when you start digging up a road, we have no idea what we're going to find. Of course, the opposite applies, as we heard, in the United States. Those are cities designed for automobiles, but they don't work particularly well for pedestrians or cyclists or public transport either. And finally, I think one of the big structural barriers to change is the short-term nature of our aspirations and priorities in local politics. It's often said that you get the politicians that you vote for. It's very logical, but you know, how can we expect our own politicians to think longer term if we don't start doing that as well? So how can we solve these things? Working with the smart cities, there's a couple of ways that have been considered, and a couple of examples I can give you. So firstly, I think that smart cities really put citizens at the heart of their model. I'll give you an example down in Southampton. There was a road improvement scheme in Oxford Street, which had a budget of about 800k. Normally, that would have focused on improving the road services, tidying up the pavements, providing really clear signage. But early on in the process, the council said they wanted to achieve some socio-economic benefits. So we took a bit more time in the design phase. We consulted the local businesses, talked to the local communities, some very simple things to do. And this project now has revitalised the key heritage area of the city. It's created 54 jobs, raised average profits in the area by 5%, and increased trade by 10%. In addition, for the 800k that the council invested, £1.8 million has been invested commercially by businesses. So by moving that focus beyond the road, we've delivered the potential of the street, a dynamic public place that connects and combines local communities and business needs and encourages social interactions, allows the pedestrians and local motorists to coexist safely. We've talked about transport systems and metros underground, but we can also do more with our roads in terms of intelligent transport systems, such as traffic monitoring and management, pedestrian management, road user charging, public information systems, smart parking, integrated traffic light management, all of those things. Even things like an app is very useful to have. We have a Twitter Gritter line, which sounds a little bit camp, but is actually very useful. And what we've seen during winter is we've seen the number of retweets go up by a factor of hundreds in terms of useful information getting out to people. On the M25, for example, we are increasing the capacity of that orbital by some 7 to 10% by the installation of smart motorway technologies that are, again, just evolutions of existing technology in terms of sensors and lane control gantries, which regulate the speed of the traffic to an optimum level. But it's working. And so, you know, how are we going to get these sorts of things done? We really have to start thinking much longer term. Longer term thinking promotes flexible decision making, economic benefits, and private sector investments. We have to be able to balance the interfaces in transport decisions. So balancing the local needs with the regional needs, regional with national, and national with international needs. What we think we should do is this country needs a national level solution. At an individual city level, and I agree with some of the speakers today that regional and local governments, city governments, can do more. But because of the nature of the UK and the concentration of wealth in the south and in London in particular, we do need a long-term spending commitment from the governments. The government should place in statute a minimum level of infrastructure spending. 2.7% of GDP is the number that the OECD suggests is competitive in the modern world. This is something that should be legally binding. The government also needs to develop a 30-year plan. And by a plan, I mean something that is structural, costed, timetabled, and coordinated for building world-leading infrastructure. It cannot be just a list of projects. This plan needs to be beyond party politics and budget cycles, even parliament terms. And finally, if you've sorted out the spending commitments and the plan, then you need somebody to manage that plan. We need a national infrastructure commission. We don't need another government minister. I think we've probably got a fair too many at the moment already. The commission would raise awareness of the value of infrastructure and help to manage the plan, hold departments and ministers accountable for their actions. So in conclusion, I should just also touch upon the big infrastructure projects like high-speed rail and Crossrail. They do attract a great deal of debate, emotion, and unfortunately they do tend to drown out the debate on other areas. They are, however, transformational and they provide us with much needed additional capacity. They are almost certainly necessary and we should support them. However, they are not the only answer. There are other much more local solutions around place shaping and intelligent traffic management, just to name two examples, and simply changing the way our statutory bodies think about the short term and the long term needs of their environment would help. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for three, as ever, really excellent presentations. Can we just have a few minutes now for questions? So hands up and I'll try to get 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's start here. You. Wait for a, can we get a microphone down here, please, to the front? There we go. Chase the microphone.
Take a more prominent decision if I may to make this statement. My worst fears have been fulfilled during the course of the day, that the most important issue facing mankind is, of course, climate change. It hasn't even been mentioned, but it's almost as if there was a determination on the part of those who programmed today's timetable and of those speakers, every one of them, to, in effect, put blinkers over this subject. Are the speakers at this conference, or those who organised it, totally unaware of the fact that the International Panel on Climate Change a few months ago said that the planet has got a finite capacity to go on absorbing into the global atmosphere further burning of fossil fuels beyond 260 tonnes megatons of carbon, absolutely overriding consideration. And yet in this last session, three speakers have all talked about the relationship between the growth of cities and the importance of transport to those cities, how essential it is that we have a transport infrastructure which caters for the growth in population, the great caters for the growth in housing, that caters for the growth in population. Somehow as if it can't happen because we haven't thought about it. This puts me in mind of the proposition. Are all the speakers of this conference, either they are totally unaware of the significance of climate change, or they don't want to know about it, or that they have thought about it but thought it is too complex a subject to even debate. I am absolutely at a loss to understand how anybody can now be talking in the way that we've heard during the course of the day. Thank you.
Okay, well, there's a challenge to three speakers. And can I just say, I don't think, I mean, I've known Mayor for 30 years and he's been entirely consistent on this. I don't think we can turn our face away from the need to get to a sort of, you know, zero carbon city. I mean, the sort of experimentation which, ironically, of all places, and its best manifestation in China, although the Arab program, as I understand it, has ground to a halt there. I mean, I see public transport, I have to say, as being part of a solution that takes people away, part of the solution that takes people away, but we clearly need to go on further. If we're going to introduce electric vehicles, then we have to make sure the energy is clean and so on. I mean, I wonder what the panel's reaction to this is, without, if you like, getting into a rather sterile debate about the merits or otherwise of climate change.
Yes, I think you're correct, and I agree. Public transportation, it's not zero carbon, but it is a big marginal step in the right direction. having all of these people move to the cities, having New York's population increase by a million, having London's population increase by more than a million over the past 25 years, every crowded bus or crowded tube car and every person on a bicycle are people who are not in private vehicles, and they also live in a much smaller space. If you are living in small apartments and not in a big suburban home, you are not having to heat that home, you are not having to drive to work. So this is imperfect, but it is going in the right direction.
Any further burning
let the panel answer your question. Tony.
Well, I think it was actually. I strongly agree with that point because we're not having, we don't have, and you wouldn't, I doubt, go to conferences about the countryside where the population is growing. Where if, to take the point that's just been made, if the same people were filling up the countryside, they'd be living in larger houses, consuming much, much more energy. They wouldn't be travelling by public transport. They'd have three or four cars rather than the average in London, which is actually way, way, way below that. And in the ward where I live, car ownership's down to 23%. So, you know, cities may be bad. You may not want any economic growth. I get that. It's a perfectly respectable point of view. But actually, cities, by containing growth, give us a better chance of delivering the kind of objectives you're looking for than developing the same number of people, the same population growth, spread out thinly across the country. So, you know, cities at least are accidentally, and it may be accidental, but they are actually doing their bit. And if you look at the registration of among 17 and 18-year-olds in cities in particular in this city, new driver's licenses, it is falling. So, you know, it's not as if there aren't signs that reality is delivering some of what you want. All I'd say is this, that, you know, this can be done without us, as it were, expressly saying it all the time. I think cities are rather good, actually, at driving down energy cost per head in a nice, easy-to-deliver way without it becoming too much of a challenge to everyone.
I think what's really interesting about the rural economy in the UK, and I suspect it's the same in the US, with much more land area than, of course, we have, is that even in the UK, only 3% of the rural population works on the land. Yeah. 97% of them work in what you can really call low-density urban jobs. I mean, they enjoy the luxury of doing them in a different environment, but they're essentially what people who are doing city-based work.
To make that point at scale, I mean, this is I find this fact rather shocking, but the economic output of the West End of London is very central, very, very, very public transport delivered, very productive part of the city, is three times the size of the whole output of agriculture in the United Kingdom. That's pretty, pretty concentratedly productive, I would have thought.
As someone said, if you love nature, stay away from it.
Yeah, I mean, I would just say two things. One, in terms of your point about it being ignored during the conference, I think we haven't been explicit, but implicitly, a lot of the things we're talking about are measures and plans to develop better ways of doing things. So, for example, in Balfour Beatty, I can talk about the 35,000 engineers that we have. At any given time, I would suggest around about 20% of them are working on ways to reduce the impact on the environment in every which way. And in terms of the other point, I agree with my other panelists that cities are a very effective and efficient way of managing down the impacts that we have. We are where we are. What we have to do is try and get better. And I think generally that argument has been won. We do need to
improve. Right. Other questions? Question behind. Yeah.
Sorry, Stephen Greenhouse, background as a local authority leader in Hampstead and Fulham, watched the town hall go to my political opponents, although I wasn't involved in the campaign. It was deeply depressing. Steve kindly reminded me of that just before the panel session. And in fact, I spent 10 years in opposition thinking about some of the local solutions that the panel touched upon, and thought about how the West London Line could form the basis of significant regeneration, economic development, and actually transform very deprived communities over a long period of time. The administration has booted out with an excellent record. I think, frankly. Now, it's arguable, we can argue about that, but I think your point about taking a long-term view with the politics around taking bold decisions is very, very important. But I want to ask a more uplifting question than that, which is, you know, I've just read the PwC brochure, Cities of Opportunity. I'd like to ask the panel, knowing London as you do, where do you see the huge opportunity to do the things you're talking about in principle? For instance, I believe in my borough, the most exciting opportunity is Park Royal and Old Oak, with Park Royal City. I think we can deliver a new city for London, really through that land capture that all of you have been talking about. That, when I went around that with Terry Farrell, that excited me the most. I simply saw that you could literally deliver that and transform all the surrounding area with an agglomeration of commerce and housing that would link to high-speed rail and frankly transform that very deprived part of London. I'm very excited by that opportunity. What opportunities does the panel see if we look around the whole of London?
Incidentally, the area of other common that Steve's referring to is certainly comparable with Hudson's Yard in New York. It's ostensibly as big as Docklands. It's an enormous opportunity, and you ask most Londoners where it is, they haven't got the vaguest idea. It's a land that God forgot in London, and yet it's got extraordinary opportunity attaching to it. Maybe you start from the other end of the table, Tony.
Well, I mean, I do agree Park Royal is an area of outstanding, an outstanding railway opportunities actually up till now, but it will be an area for outstanding development opportunities. I mean, it shares in common with a number of other places like Stratford, where the Olympics have obviously created a kickstart to development. Places that were actually quite well connected and not far from the city centre, but which in the long period of deindustrialisation in London from the late 50s right the way through to the early 80s were gradually abandoned. Well, of course, now the whole process is in reverse and these places can be brought back into use again. Actually, I mean, I agree about Park Royal. I have to say that a huge swathe of inner south London seems to me ripe for development of all kinds. I mean, there's so much of inner south London that could be and is being gradually being is being developed, and there are other sites besides. You know, Cricklewood is being developed also slowly but surely. Well, not that slowly actually. So inner south London would be my tip for the top.
Yeah, Kevin.
I'm afraid I'm going to be typecast and be suggesting that Crossrail too. And the north-south line would be something that would get my vote.
Yeah.
I think heavy rail is absolutely essential for the growth of our businesses and our city.
What would your big opportunity area be in New York, you reckon, Nicole?
Well, I agree that places with extra transit capacity, partly because of deindustrialization, we still have places like that. There's an area called Jamaica, Queens, not far from the airport. It's about a 25-minute commute on the more expensive commuter rail, maybe $8 a ride. On the subway, it's about $2 in an hour commute, but it has good both heavy rail and commuter rail transit capacity. And it's not very dense. You walk around the main thoroughfares of Jamaica, the residential and businesses, they're only 2-3 stories high. You could build 20-30 story apartment buildings that would be middle class, working class housing, and do this with some kind of businesses that might have to do with import-export because you are so close to the airport. There are other places like that too. Much of the Bronx is still very, very low density for New York City.
I'm terribly sorry, but time marches on. The one thing I do know is that if I don't get you out of the drinks in time, I'll be shot. So do forgive me that we've run out of time for questions. You see, the very, very last slot here is what is referred to as closing remarks. I was only going to say this. The title of the conference was The Future of Post-Industrial Cities. Given that half of the world's population live in cities now, given that by 2035, 70% of the world's population are going to live in cities, I can't think that there is a more important, a more significant challenge facing humanity in general
and in particular great cities like London and New York than how we deal with our post-industrial future. And incidentally, I have noted myself that central to that is the challenge of sustainability, the challenge of climate change and reversing our carbon consumption patterns. It's about public transport infrastructure. I think Nicole referred to that as not so much a transport investment but as an anti-poverty investment. We know that public transport allows cities to operate infinitely more efficiently, both in terms of energy but also in terms of the way they get the people without jobs to the jobs without people. And one of the great successes of London in past generation, the past decade, has been precisely the explosion of investment in that infrastructure, something that I know New York is aiming to rectify. I would only say, incidentally, that if you gave responsibility for the budget of London Transport to the leaders of Manchester and Birmingham City Councils, you'd probably get about as much investment as New York City gets from Albany. But that's a structural issue that you guys are going to have to solve, and which I wish you very well with. What I thought was really interesting about today, and I think those of us who've been here all day, and I was delighted to be here all day, it takes a lot to get me to stay at any conference all day, even if I am the chairman, which is that the speaker quality has been universally superb. It really has. It would be inappropriate for me to run through a list of names, because I actually do think the quality has been so universal that you'll join with me in knowing that we've had a really quite privileged a day today, listening to excellent speeches on such a large swathe of areas of interest. Areas around the concepts of decentralisation of powers, a great theme running through, very, very current here in the United Kingdom. Indeed, the challenge that says, well, if it's good enough for London, and if we in London can actually identify the improvements that we've had in the 14 years since the mayoralty was instituted and the two mayors that we've had, if we can see that change, then why aren't we perhaps in this country mandating that kind of new governance structure to other great cities, and then accompany it in this country? We have a great debate about whether we and Scotland should undo three centuries of history. If you ask most people, I just say this with the benefit of my American friends, if you ask most people what they think, in England they say, you know what, we wouldn't miss them, they're always moaning and they consume a hell of a lot of more money than we do. And if in Scotland you say, well, frankly, whenever Americans refer to the English, they generally mean the British, and you can't imagine how upsetting that is if you're a Scotsman. Here's another thought. What's the premise? The premise is actually decentralisation of powers. If it works for Scotland, if it works for London, then why doesn't it work for all the regions of the United Kingdom, and particularly for the city regions, which are so vital to the economic health of this country? But that's somewhere where I have to say US has been much more advanced than we have, or by accident or design, has got there a lot quicker than we have. I thought what was really interesting is deregulation in planning. I have absolutely not the slightest doubt that in London the reason why there is such a chronic undersupply of housing and why prices are at literally, indecent levels is because the planning system applies a huge, great restriction on that supply like a noose round a neck. And until that noose is loosened, then we are going to go on, as I say, producing housing at prices that no young person can afford. The average age of a first-time buyer in London is now 41. Speaking as a senior, we get lots of privileges, but I hadn't ever imagined that I'd live to see the day when you'd be a senior before you could afford to earn your own home. That's an extraordinary proposition. Deregulation in terms of business investment. One of the issues that Lord Heseltine talked about at lunch in his wide-ranging speech based on such enormous experience. Deregulation in business investment, deregulation in welfare. Fascinating proposition that you can deregulate, if you like, and again, in a sense, decentralize welfare systems so as to get much better value for the budgets, the enormous budgets that we spend. And more importantly, that universal theme that suggests that in cities, the vast majority of people actually would prefer to work than not, and that what we have to do is to encourage that notion that work is of itself life-enhancing. And that's something I believe that many people who currently don't enjoy the privilege of being in jobs are well aware of. It's a fascinating a panorama of challenges that cities face. I can't think of a better way to have spent a day than to have been in a conference like this listening to such high-quality speakers. So I'm just going to finish by thanking both PwC, who have supported today, for which we're very grateful, to the City of London Corporation, who've also supported us and kindly hosted us here in Ironmongers Hall, and of course to both the Manhattan Institute for their enormous contribution to the success of the day, and to Policy Exchange, clearly the nation's leading think tank, I'm delighted to say, for its management, for its leadership, and for setting us on the right agenda today. Thank you all very, very much indeed for coming. I hope you've enjoyed it. Go and enjoy a drink next door. You all deserve it. You stuck it out.